Remember the early 2000s?
Jamming, man.
Pants sat low, phones were bricks, and Green Day was having a moment. But if you were a climate scientist, you were probably focused on a different hot topic, carbon capture and storage. So basically, capturing CO2 from a plant that burns fossil fuels and burying it underground. The technology promised to become key in fighting climate change.
The most effective way to help Alberta meet its emission reduction goals.
Now, the world has changed a lot in the last 20 years.
But CCS is still not that widespread.
They have failed to meet the promise, both in terms of the quantity or the quality of what they're doing.
So what exactly happened? And what can we learn from these promises when we look at newer carbon capture technologies? When you look at all the ways we can capture carbon, the names look like an alphabet soup of acronyms. But we're going to focus on two of the most talked about technologies: carbon capture and storage, which traps emissions right at the source, and direct air capture, which sucks CO2 directly out of the air.
And to understand why we're doing this, we need to look at this bathtub. The tub is our atmosphere, and the water is the greenhouse gases we keep adding to it.
We keep adding CO2 to that bathtub, but we don't want it to overflow because that would mean a tipping point for the planet, right?
This is Judith Hebekeuser, a press officer for Climeworks, a Swiss company specializing in direct air capture technology.
One way of course, having to do this is turning down the taps. And that's what we understand as emission reductions. And that's what should be prioritized above all else.
But realistically speaking, we can't stop all polluting industries from one day to another. Turning off those faucets is a slow process.
So scientists thought, why not intercept some of the emissions right at the source? That's what the first type of carbon capture we're looking at does. CCS, or carbon capture and storage, sucks up a portion of the CO2 released at a fossil fuel plant. Then companies can transport that CO2 elsewhere to store it away by injecting it into rocks, into the seabed, or into old oil fields, which ironically helps extract more oil. But more on that later.
This technology has been used for a few decades now. But there's also a second option, direct air capture, or DAC, which in comparison is still baby tech.
Here, giant fans suck in air and pass it through a filter or through chemicals to trap CO2 particles. These can be collected and stored underground. So basically, it targets CO2 that's already in the atmosphere.
So imagine a spoon with which you can take a tiny bit of water out of that bathtub. And to stop this bathtub from overflowing, we need to develop carbon removal solutions.
Top climate experts agree that capturing carbon directly from smokestacks and removing it from the atmosphere is essential to help us become climate neutral by 2050. Especially because for sectors like cement or steel, there aren't many technological options to reduce emissions. But we are severely lagging behind. These technologies are only capturing 0.1% of our global emissions. In 2030, large-scale CCS and DAC plants are projected to have the capacity to capture this much CO2. But this is how much needs to be captured if we want to achieve net zero by 2050. That means balancing how many greenhouse gases we emit with how many we avoid or remove. Even with all these projects under development, we will be hundreds of megatons short of our target.
Meaning we're playing a massive game of catch-up.
In the 90s, and particularly in the early 2000s, there was an awful lot of promising about carbon capture and storage.
Duncan McLaren researches climate politics at UCLA Law.
It was embraced by fossil fuel companies. It was seen as, here's the way to square our emissions targets, but to go on operating.
In the International Energy Agency's roadmap at the time, the goal was to have 100 carbon capture and storage projects operational by 2020. Now, 4 years after this deadline, we have just over 40 commercial CCS plants. We're not even halfway there. And while some of these projects are heralded as successes, the list of failures is much longer.
There have been a handful of full-scale plants built using CCS, most of which have subsequently shut down because they're not financially viable.
More than three-quarters of large-scale projects initiated between 1995 and 2018 were called off or put on hold. That's according to a 2021 study.
And even the projects that did take off didn't always meet their targets.
Just look at Chevron's liquefied natural gas plant in Australia. It has one of the world's largest CCS systems with the capacity to store up to 4 million tons of CO2. That's about as much as the island of Madagascar emits in a year. But since it was inaugurated in 2019, it never once met that capacity. In the last fiscal year, it only injected 1.7 million tons underground, not even half of what was promised. Chevron told us in an email that this was because issues with the system's pressure management limited how much CO2 could be injected, and that they're fixing the infrastructure so that they can start injecting more. But the company didn't specify how long this would take. Gorgon is just one of many CCS plants plagued by problems.
For some of them, money was the issue, and that's the thing about CCS. It may look simple in this very oversimplified demonstration here, but it's complicated and expensive.
In the early 2000s, the expectation was that it was going to get cheaper as the technology got better and was scaled up.
Now, the owners of carbon capture facilities are not very generous in sharing the information about how well their projects do or how expensive it is to capture CO2.
David Schlissel is an analyst with the Institute for Energy Economics and Financial Analysis, a global think tank.
What's happened over time is there's no evidence the cost of carbon capture has gone down.
It's pretty hard to pinpoint what exactly the price of capturing carbon is. The range is pretty big because it depends on the nature of the project and what the source of emissions is. But it's about $15 to $120 per metric ton that is captured.
Just for reference, a ton of CO2 is what one passenger emits on a flight from New York to Paris. So multiply that price by the billions of tons we will have to capture for this tech to be effective.
One way technologies get cheaper is to scale them, but that's really hard with CCS plants, which have complex designs that need to be customized. That's because there are a lot of variables. What type of fossil fuel plant is it? Where's the CO2 going to be stored? How are companies going to get it to that storage site? They can't just be mass-produced cookie-cutter style.
For cement and steel production, where there are few alternatives, carbon capture and storage might actually still be one of the better options for now. But when it comes to sectors where we have other ways to reduce emissions, like the energy sector, for example, CCS is usually more expensive.
That makes it all the more surprising that a lot of fossil fuel companies are using this tech as a significant part of their plans to slash emissions.
Promise of CCS allowed the operators of the developers of fossil fuel power stations to say, it's fine, we can go ahead with this now because we will be able to retrofit this technology onto the plant and cut emissions in 5 or 10 or 15 years' time.
According to the research organization Bloomberg NEF, Big Oil has actually been pivoting away from investing into renewables, increasingly putting their money into solutions that keep their current business model viable, like carbon capture and storage. ExxonMobil, for example, is going all in on that route and fully ignoring renewables. Another thing about capturing carbon is that it's very often used to, well, extract more oil. The majority of CCS plants pump the CO2 they trapped into aging fuels to extract leftovers.
Because oil is really sticky and thick, so when you try to pump it out of a reservoir, a lot of it gets left behind.
One way to get it out is to flood the field with CO2, which works kind of like a lubricant. It makes the oil more liquid and increases the pressure to get that crude out of the rock. This procedure is called enhanced oil recovery, and 70% of CCS plants use it.
The positive is it can make carbon capture more profitable, but it also means more oil.
The new oil is either used as a feedstock in a refinery or is burned. And then what happens? It creates more CO2. It's a cycle that keeps the oil and gas industry alive and profitable.
Okay, that was a lot on CCS, but there's another form of carbon capture that's getting more and more attention. Direct air capture.
There are only four large-scale DAC plants around the world, two of them in Iceland. That's also where the largest facility is. Climeworks' mammoth plant has the capacity to suck up to 36,000 tons of CO2 out of the atmosphere every year. In the grand scheme of things, that's a minuscule amount of the more than 37 billion tons we emit from fossil fuels in a year. But it's also just the beginning.
We're yet to see the peak of the promises for direct air capture.
If we're able to expand direct air capture, it could help us target past emissions.
But there's a big bottleneck when it comes to scaling DAC, the cost.
If you thought CCS was expensive, the price to capture a ton of CO2 from the atmosphere is much higher. One ballpark figure is that it costs around $500 to $700.
energy is one of our biggest cost drivers. What many people don't know is that CO2 is actually very diluted in our atmosphere. So that means you have to move a lot of air to get to 1 ton of CO2.
Analysts and industry professionals have floated a goal when it comes to reducing costs. Hello, Benjamin Franklin. But looking at current developments, it's not really clear if it will ever become attainable to suck a ton of carbon out of the air for $100.
Climeworks announced a new technology that it says is a breakthrough in efficiency. With its new filters, it will capture more than double the CO2 than previous ones. That should halve the cost by 2030. But even then, it's still high at $250 to $350.
I think it's only natural for humans to move the goalposts if the crisis that we're in becomes more urgent, right? How do we measure the importance of our survival in the end in terms of money?
What DAC proponents argue is that the only way for prices to come down is if different ideas get a shot to compete against each other.
It's quite important for us to develop these technologies, and the only way to develop them is to actually go build things. You don't just do this all on theory.
David Keith leads the Climate Systems Engineering Initiative at UChicago. He also founded the direct air capture company Carbon Engineering, which has since been sold to Occidental Petroleum.
That's what these big industrial operations are good at doing. And that's the skill set that you need inside, whether it comes from an oil company or not. You need that kind of industrial engineering skill set to really drive these costs down.
Occidental Petroleum, or Oxy for short, is one of several fossil fuel companies investing in direct air capture and advertising this.
And this is where critics worry that this might be history repeating itself. Huge emitters hiding behind technology that is still in the works instead of making significant efforts to cut emissions elsewhere.
Oxy has big plans with its new DAC venture. It wants to deploy 100 plants by 2035. The company already broke ground on its Stratus project in Texas, which it says will become the biggest direct air capture plant in the world, with a capacity to capture 500,000 tons of CO2 per year. But at the same time, Oxy has bought up another oil and gas company.
So, clear intention to expand production.
This is Marlene Ramon Hernandez. She's a carbon removal expert at the NGO Carbon Market Watch.
It's greenwashing at its finest.
Another open question with direct air capture is what happens once the CO2 is captured.
The plants that Climeworks has running already inject the CO2 into basalt rocks or volcanic rocks, and the company says it will not engage in enhanced oil recovery. For Oxy's plants, it's not entirely clear how much will be sequestered away and how much will be used to extract more oil or produce synthetic fuels.
There are some comments in the press, for instance, of Vicky Hall of the CEO, saying that this captured DAC, if you store it permanently underground and do nothing with it, it's actually a waste of a valuable product. She's also said that this is a means to legitimize oil and gas operations.
This is what Vicky Hollop had to say in a video that the American Petroleum Institute posted on X.
If we do it right, and we are headed down a fan to do it right, then our industry will be around for 16, 17, 80 years.
This is not to say that there's no value in carbon capture technologies. The more tools we have in our arsenal to fight climate change, the better.
The problem comes with the way they are promised.
The truth of the matter is we already had lofty promises around CCS. Many years later, Big Oil is still cheerleading for it at a scale that ignores the technology's shaky track record. Now we're seeing many companies latch onto direct air capture, but this cannot become another wave of inflated goals to keep business running as usual.
It's simply cheaper to avoid a ton of CO2 today than to take it out of the atmosphere.
Otherwise, 20 years from now, we will look back to today and realize we overpromised once again.
What do you think? Will carbon capture technologies deliver on their promises? Let us know what you think, and don't forget to subscribe to our channel.